So in our last lecture, we were looking at interpolation, interpolation polynomial. We also looked at cubic spline interpolation. So I talked about piecewise polynomial interpolation towards the end. Well, let me explain a few things before I move on about piecewise polynomial interpolation. We have this function uz, and we know values of this function at different points, and then we wanted to fit a polynomial that passes through each of these points. Okay, so one possibility was to develop a very high order polynomial which passes through each of these points. So that would be a continuous function passing through each of these points. There are other options. As I said, that finding out coefficients of a very high order polynomial, higher than 3 or 4, becomes an ill-conditioned problem. It's difficult to find the coefficients. So we resort to what is called as piecewise polynomial approximation. And one particular type of approximation I talked yesterday. So if I want to develop a piecewise polynomial approximation, what is the simplest piecewise polynomial approximation? Well, not cubic. The simplest one will be linear line. You know, the simplest one would be just a line that I could develop a line that connects these two points, then another line that connects these two points. What is the problem with this? This is fine. In some cases, this works. This is useful. I'm not saying this is not useful, but this approximation, piecewise linear approximation, is not differentiable at the boundary points. It's not differentiable. Okay, so it's continuous, but it's not differentiable. Okay, so that's why we want to have higher order approximations. We could then think of approximating this using second order, that is quadratic equation. So each one of them, instead of a line, can be a quadratic equation. Okay, so this might be and so on. Okay, now if you are fitting, in general, you could fit kth order polynomial, say quadratic, cubic, fourth order. We normally stop at cubic. And among the piecewise polynomial approximations, the approximation for which we match derivatives up to k minus 1. Suppose you are fitting a kth order polynomial between each segment, and you match the derivatives up to k minus 1th order, then that is called as a spline approximation. Okay, so cubic spline, when I say cubic spline, that's because we are matching first order and second order derivatives. Polynomial order is 3, first and second order derivatives are matched for smoothness purpose, so that's why it's cubic spline. Normally we use cubic spline because beyond that, it's not worth fitting higher order polynomials beyond cubic. Cubic many times suffices for most of the applications. So you can very well develop piecewise linear approximation, piecewise quadratic approximation, piecewise cubic approximation. Okay, so depending upon what is your what level of smoothness you need in your application, in some cases differentiability is not so important. You can have piecewise linear. Okay, in some cases differentiability is important, so you should have higher order polynomials and match derivatives and so on. So this is a small point. The next point that I want to make here is that when I am developing this, when I am developing this approximation, is it necessary that I only do a polynomial approximation? It's not necessary that I only do polynomial approximation. I can do functional approximation. Okay. So in general, my approximating, I mean, this is just, we are not going to use when we do boundary value problem discretization, or when I develop this orthogonal collocation method, I'm not going to use functional approximation. This is just a side note I'm using the word approximation. Function interpolation. We'll be using approximation in a different context. Just like I can do polynomial interpolation, I can do function interpolation. So in general, let's say I have this. I'll just slightly change the notation. You have this uz here, and till now we were looking at polynomial approximation, which means we said that pt is alpha 0 plus alpha 1 okay, and then this was the initial Lagrange interpolation, and then we know these values of u z I is equal to u I. We know these values at I going from 1, 2, up to n plus 1. We know values of u I, and then we wrote n plus 1 equations in n plus 1 unknowns, and then we had a simple way of finding out alpha 0, alpha 1 by matrix inversion. This we have discussed earlier. Okay, it is not necessary that I approximate only using interpolate only using polynomials. Not approximate, I interpolate. Approximation will come when you approximate boundary value problem. Right now, interpolation is something in which you try to construct a function that passes through every point. Okay, so this is a polynomial function that passes through every point here. Okay, passes through every point. Now, I could also develop, say, another function gz. This is a function of z, not of t. I could develop another function which is interpolating function, and I would call this as some beta 1 f1 z plus beta 2 f2 z. Let's keep the notation similar. So let's call this beta 0 f0, beta 1 f1, up to beta n in general. I need not approximate using simple, or I need not represent this polynomial using simple polynomial functions. I could have more complex functions appearing here. So this is called function interpolation. Each one of them is a function of z. Okay. For example, I could use some of the standard polynomials, say Legendre polynomial here. Okay. Or I could use a shifted Legendre polynomial. Depending upon the context, you could use different kinds of. I could use here sine and cos. Okay, I could use here sine and cos. So it is not necessary that interpolation should be only through polynomial. Interpolation can be through functions. This will be called an interpolating function. Okay, and how do you estimate beta 0 to beta n? The same thing, you take, write this equation, u1 is equal to beta 0 f1 z1 plus beta 1 f0 f1 and then u2 is equal to beta 0 f0 z2 plus beta 1 f1 z2 z2, and likewise you can write this for all the points. And I have u n plus 1 is equal to beta 0 f0 zn plus 1 plus beta 1 f1 . So I have n plus 1 equations in n plus 1 unknowns. What are the unknowns here? Beta 0, beta 1 up to beta n. These are the unknowns. These functions here, f0, f1, interpolating functions, I have chosen them. I know these functions, like sine, cos, or whatever you choose. Okay? I have chosen these functions. So I can substitute values of z and find out the value of that particular function. So here, this would be known, because I have chosen the function, I can evaluate the function at a particular point, and I can then write this into the standard form, because this will give rise to u is equal to A matrix into theta, where theta is nothing but beta 0 to beta n. This vector theta is beta 0 to beta n. A matrix will have, what will A matrix have? All this f0, z1, f1, z1, all these values of this. This A matrix is known, and then you can find an interpolating function. You can find an interpolating, or this is called function interpolation. So this is a special case of function interpolation. Okay, you have chosen a special function which is simple polynomial, but that need not be the only way to construct interpolating function. Okay, you can do in general function interpolation. So well, interpolation is if you look at textbooks on applied mathematics, you'll find much more material on interpolation. Right now my interest is in discretizing a problem. Okay, so I'm going to restrict myself to whatever I need for problem discretization. So my aim is now to convert a boundary value problem or a partial differential equation into a set of either algebraic equations which have to be solved simultaneously, or in some cases it could be differential equation that need to be solved simultaneously. We have seen several cases, right? What is going to be different here is how we approximate the derivatives. What was the key in the earlier case when you use Taylor series method? The key was approximation of first order and second order derivatives. Okay, so interpolating function or interpolating polynomial is going to be used for approximation of local derivatives. Okay, so the word approximation comes when you start discretizing, not when we construct an interpolating polynomial. So the trick is going to be same. I am going to develop some what did we do when we developed finite difference method? We started with Taylor series, we looked at a point, right, and we said local derivative of this particular function can be approximated using Taylor series expansion, and then we had this forward difference, backward difference formula for approximating the local derivative at ith grid point. We divided the entire domain into number of grid points, right, and then at a particular grid point, ith grid point, we had a way of constructing local approximation of the first derivative and second derivative. Okay, same thing is going to be done here. I'm going to use this interpolating polynomial to construct local derivatives, approximation of the local derivatives at the grid points. Okay, now look carefully at the development, because this is something which is new for you, for most of you, and somewhat different from finite difference in some sense, is covered when you in your undergraduate in many cases, many of you would have visited finite difference, but orthogonal collocation probably is not part of a typical undergraduate program. So now let's start looking at how we develop this orthogonal collocation. So I have this domain. So this is again, this is z is equal to 0, and then this is my z is equal to 1. And I have this similar notation. So this is my z1, this is my z2, this is my z3, this is zi. Okay, these are my grid points in a domain 0 to 1. Well, this domain appears in the context of let's say a boundary value problem. So let's rewrite our boundary value problem again. So the general boundary value problem is so in the domain 0 to 1, I want this differential equation to hold actually at every point, but when we do discretization, we will end up forcing this equation only at certain grid points, the same way that we have done for finite difference. And then I have these boundary conditions F1, so I have two boundary conditions and I have this second order differential equation. I need to develop approximations for d2u by dz square, du by dz, and then at a particular point, let's say ith point, I want to develop local approximation for the derivatives. Okay, and now the way I'm going to proceed is let's denote the value of the solution at these points as u1, u2. So basically the same idea where we had said that ui is equal to u of zi, where u is the dependent variable here, the solution of the problem. It could be temperature distribution, it could be concentration distribution, whatever is the problem at hand. Okay. So this is my solution. Now the trouble is in when you are solving a partial differential equation and when you are trying to develop an interpolation polynomial, you do not know these values u1, u2, u3 up to, you do not know these values. Okay, so the trick is use interpolation polynomial together with this differential equation to find u1, u2, u3 up to un plus 1. Okay, so when I begin with the development, okay, I'm going to develop everything in terms of u1 to un, okay, as unknowns. Now let's see how we do this. So now what I'm going to do is my approximate solution to this problem, okay, I'm going to represent as a polynomial, as a interpolation polynomial. So let me call this as uz is equal to alpha 0 plus alpha 1 z okay. This is my proposed solution. approximate solution, okay, for this particular problem. Okay, now if you want to develop interpolation polynomial, what will you do? You will write these equations. U1 is equal to alpha 0 plus alpha 1 z1 up to alpha n zn, right? Then U2 alpha 2 plus 2 zn. So you would write all these equations. Okay, I'll write all these equations. U1, U2 up to UN, these are the values of this solution, approximate solution at the grid points. Okay, right now I have not talked about how to decide these grid points. In this context, they are often called as knots or collocation points. They are not really called as grid points. Just a matter of terminology. They are same as grid points. Okay, they are often called as collocation points. So these points here will be called as collocation points. Okay, so now I can write this, and then I can put this into the standard matrix form 1 Okay, so these equations, n plus 1 equations into n plus 1 unknowns, I have transformed into a standard matrix equation. Now there is a trouble here. Okay, in normal interpolation, when it is not connected with a differential equation, you are given some values of the function at the grid points. So in normal polynomial interpolation, you know these values. You know these values. Now I don't know these values right now. Okay, doesn't matter. I'm going to play some tricks. First of all, in this equation, I don't know two things. I don't know alpha 0, alpha 1, 2, alpha n. I do not know u1, 2, un plus 1. So both I do not know. So I cannot really solve this problem and find the solution. That is not possible. The solution is tied up with the differential equation. Okay, so we have to go to differential equation to get these values. But what I'm going to do here is, let's call this matrix as A matrix, this vector as theta vector, and this vector here as capital U, A theta equal to U. So this my equation is A theta equal to U. Okay, so I'm going to transform this equation and write theta is equal to A inverse. Theta is equal to A inverse into capital U. Capital U is this vector, U1 to UN plus 1. Okay. So what I have done is I have said that this set of unknowns can be represented in terms of this set of unknowns. Okay. Let's leave here and then let's continue with the next part. Okay. Now let's come to ith collocation point. Okay. So at ith collocation point, what is the solution, approximate solution? UZI, well, before I go to the ith collocation point, what is the general solution? Uz is alpha 0 plus alpha 1 z up to alpha n zn, right? This is the approximate solution. What is its first derivative? What is du by dz? Du by dz is 0 plus alpha 1 plus 2 alpha 2 z up to n alpha n z n minus 1. Everyone with me on this? Okay, I am going to write this in slightly different way. I am going to say that this is 0, 1, 2, I am going to write this as an inner product of two vectors. One vector is 0, 1, 2z, 3z square, 4z cube and so on. Okay. So this has been written as inner product of two vectors, dot product of two vectors. Okay. So far so good. So now we need so here now this first derivative is actually so this du by dz is equal to 0, 1, 2z, n z raised to n minus 1 into theta. Do you agree with me? Because this is the theta vector. This is my theta vector. So this into theta vector, okay, which is same as 0, 1, 2z into A inverse u. I am just replacing theta. Unknown theta are not so convenient for me to work with. I am going to work with unknowns u1 to un plus 1. Okay. So this is a known matrix. A is a known matrix. Okay. I have chosen the collocation points. So I can compute A matrix. Okay. I can compute A inverse. So this is a known matrix to me. Okay. Now this multiplication of this vector into this matrix, I am going to denote it by, see, this is a vector. This is a row vector. This is a n cross n matrix, n plus 1 cross n plus 1 matrix. And this is a vector which is 1 cross n plus 1. Okay. So multiplication of these two, this vector, row vector into this matrix, what will it give you? Another row vector. I'm going to call this row vector as Si is the ith row vector, okay, or the row vector associated with the ith collocation point. Okay, so I have represented, okay, 1 minute. So there's one more step in between. We have to so this is the general expression for the derivative. Now I want to find a derivative at the ith collocation point. So how will you find out? So here you'll have to put zi. Okay. So du zi by dz will be 0, 1, 2 zi, n zi raised to n minus 1 into a u. Okay. When I want to compute the derivative at the ith collocation point, I am just going to substitute for z equal to zi. I will get this expression. A inverse U, yeah, A inverse U. A inverse U. Now this quantity, this quantity I am going to denote as Si, that is 0, 1, 2 Zi into A inverse. Okay, this is my row vector. This is a row vector. What you get here is a row vector. Okay, so this will be 1 cross n plus 1 row vector. Okay, and then what I get, a very simple expression, du zi by dz is equal to si into u. Is everyone with me on this? Right, so the derivative approximation at ith collocation point is this vector times u. What is u? u1 to un plus 1. Okay, likewise I can develop my second order derivative. Can you do that? So what is my d2u by dz square? What is my d2u by dz square? So this would be 0 0 0 0. Second derivative will give you only 2. Okay, then 2, then what will you get? 6 z. N into n minus 1 z raised to n minus z raised to n minus 2. Am I correct? If I write it in terms of into theta, but what is theta? A inverse u. So A inverse u, right? I am just skipping in between steps. They are very simple. Same derivation as previous derivation for the first order derivative. So I am just directly writing the final form here. Okay, you will get this vector and you will get this A inverse times u. Okay, when I want to compute the derivative at ith collocation point, so I would just substitute d2u